the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. You may be seated. Well, even after photographing it and nothing else for 7 years straight, the Japanese photographer Takashi Miyazawa still only cares to capture Mount Fuji with his camera. You can see his work on the latest cover of National Geographic. In fact, this one photographer, over this seven-year time span, has amassed over 70,000 pictures of this mountain. Here's a man that is devoted a pretty good portion of his professional career as an artist to one subject only. This striking snow-capped peak of this tremendous Japanese monument. I've never been there, but if you see the mountain from Takashi's perspective through his photographs, you can understand why it is such a glorious focal point. Not only do you see this beautiful towering peak of a mountain that stretches into the heavens, but it's also surrounded by bodies of water and lush forests and villages, and each one offering its own perspective of this ever-present mountain. Each picture taken by this man, Takashi, features a slightly different perspective, or captures the mountain in a different light or a time of day. But ironically enough, when asked how many times he's scaled the mountain, how many times he's climbed it, this mountain, and he's devoted so much of his time and his attention, his life's work to, he responds with this: climb it. I never thought to climb it. Why would I climb it? If I climbed it, I wouldn't be able to photograph it. Seems logical. As humans, we have a very forgetful streak in us. Unless we keep something immediately in our view, we can very easily forget it or ignore it. If our eyes aren't continually fixed, we can lose heart or lose focus. Our attention strays, our minds wander. And Paul tells us this morning in 2 Corinthians that he always carries with him, in his body, the death of Christ Jesus, that the life of Jesus may also be manifested through him. It's an odd expression, don't you think? To carry around with you the crucified, dead body of Christ. But even as death is working in us, Paul says, even as death is working in us, life is working through you. This verse immediately follows one of those passages in Paul's writing that almost feels like poetry. He says, you're hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We're perplexed, but not in despair. We're persecuted, but we're not forsaken. Struck down, we are not destroyed. Paul and his companions, those that travel with him, are persistent through bodily discomfort and external opposition, all for the sake of delivering this gospel to those whom the Lord has chosen to hear his message. For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, he said, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Jesus came to offer relief to the dying, to give new life through his own death, to restore that relationship between God and man through the new covenant in his blood. John 20 says that believing we may have life in his name. It's a truth that we hold in our hearts as Christians. But often it's buried too deep to truly affect the way we live our lives, the way we interact with each other. If we've been forgiven, then shouldn't that affect whether or not we forgive each other? If we've been shown mercy, shouldn't that affect how much mercy we're willing to show each other? Paul says, I have to carry his death around with me so that I can remember, just so I can allow his life to also show through me. When we remember the death of Christ, or when we look upon a cross or a crucifix, that should be a very personal moment for us. He did this for me, and I didn't deserve it. Our gospel reading picks up the story. Jesus and his followers are journeying along. They're wandering through some grain fields and picking the heads of grain as they go. Whether or not they're just kind of snacking on them, I don't know. It sounds disgusting. Or they're going to, you know, make bread later. I don't know what the context is. But bottom line is they're doing it, but they're doing it on the Sabbath. And the Pharisees, who are always looking for any little indiscretion or misdemeanor they can catch him on, say, aha, you're a bunch of lawbreakers. Look what you're doing. You're harvesting on the day of rest. Clearly illegal, according to the Mosaic law. Jesus turns the table and gives them an example from one of their heroes, David. He said, well, you know, David broke the law by eating the consecrated bread in the tabernacle. Do you condemn him as well? The principle of the Sabbath is for the benefit of man. It's not meant to be a rigid, oppressive concept that causes you to be hungry for an entire 24-hour period. He says, the Son of Man is also Lord of the Sabbath. I think many people believe that there are parts of the Christian walk of faith that can easily become rigidly restrictive in the same way that the Pharisees saw the Mosaic law. But the truth is, our status as children of God should be a continuous revelation of joy to us. We're not immune to the heartache that's around us, or the death and destruction and disease that's happening in our world. But as children of God, we are forgiven. We're signed and sealed as Christ's own forever. We've been adopted. And our place in the kingdom is assured. That should be a revelation of joy. That's part of our journey. As we carry around the death of Christ in our body, what does that mean? It means that we've been forgiven. It means that he did that for us. It's the reason why Paul can so assuredly say to his readers, it doesn't matter what happens to us in the body. It doesn't matter what hardships or difficulty life throws at us. We can face all these trials, all these hardships. We'd face them all with joy in our hearts, knowing that God is with us through it all. Blessed be the living God who redeemed us from the fall, who raised us up to new life, and who plants joy and life into our hearts. Amen.